Greetings and blessed day to you once again, people of God. It's the Revelator once again, and hoping the grace and the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ is with you until the end of time. Now, before we enter into today's presentation, I just want to give you a brief reminder of what we covered months ago. Months ago, we presented the fornication demon, and inside that presentation, I exposed the fornication as a demon. It was almost 6 months ago. And today, we enter into the second segment, which is now going to be the fornication demon part two. And hoping those that listen to part one, you are equipped by the word that allows you to have the power and the abstinence against this demon. And today in the fornication demon part two, I want to talk about the sexual idolatry, so that you may understand that there is a level of not just committing fornication, but worshipping fornication through sexual idolatry. And for us to understand more on the fornication demon too, which is now the sexual idolatry, let us get into scriptures. In the book of John chapter 8 verse 31, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed. We are Abraham's seed, and we were never in bondage to any man. How do you say then that we shall be made free? And Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever commits a sin is a servant of sin. Jesus is telling them that whosoever commits a sin is a servant of sin. But Jesus did not describe what manner of sin he was referring unto. And you do know that the word sin is a portfolio that describes different categories and criterias of commitments of sin. And Jesus never went into detail to explain to them which sin in particular he was referring unto. And they rushed to say, we are Abraham's seed and we're never in bondage. And after Jesus has lectured them on the commitment of sin, and regarded that whosoever commits sin is a servant of sin, and the servant abides not in the house forever, but the son abides. If the son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me. Why? Because my word has no place in you. I speak that which I've seen my father, and you do that which you have seen in your father. They claimed to be Abraham's seed. Why? Because Abraham was the father of all nations. And Jesus is saying, you do that which you have seen in your father. And the father which he is referring unto them is none other than their father Lucifer the devil. And they did not understand which father Jesus was referring unto. And Jesus was referring to Lucifer, the father of all lusts. Then they answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Then Jesus said unto them, if you are Abraham's children, then you do the works of Abraham. Why? Because Abraham was the father of faith. Abraham was the father of righteousness. Abraham was the father of obedience. He obeyed God. But now you seek to kill me, a man that has told you the truth, which I have heard of God. And this thing that you ought to do, Abraham did not do that. In 8 verse 41, Jesus further said, you do the deeds of your father. Then they said unto Jesus, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. This is where the mystery of the fornication demon part 2 begins. The sexual idolatry. And the mystery that is here is that Jesus has lectured them concerning the commitment of sin. And he has not described what manner of sin. And they have defended themselves, saying they have Abraham as their father. And Jesus has lectured them back, saying, if you are truly Abraham's children, then you would follow also the voice of God's Son. And you would follow the voice of the Father who is in heaven. And then they present a defense which appears to be contrary and which appears to be irrelevant and off topic to what Jesus was addressing. And what is it that they say? They say, we are not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. They say they are not born of fornication. They only have one father in God. Meaning that they understood that there is a level of committing fornication which was at the level of sexual idolatry. I hope someone is understanding what I'm saying. Earlier on, they have defended themselves saying they only have Abraham as their father. And then they shifted their defense in the argument and said, we only have one father, even God. And this father that they have, whom they now claim to be God, they defended themselves saying they are not born of fornication, which Jesus never accused them of. When Jesus all along was persistently accusing them of having another father, which they were now aware that Jesus was imposing the devil, the father of lust, as their father, they shifted their defense and started defending themselves against an accusation which Jesus did not hold against them. And they said they are not born of fornication. They are only submitted under one father, who is God in heaven. How does the issue of fornication get involved in the issue of submitting to a certain father? If fornication is not a form of idolatry, there is a level of sexual idolatry in fornication, in which fornication can be committed at the level of worship. A level whereby one commits fornication, and fornication becomes a certain god, and fornication takes over a generation, and fornication becomes transgenerational, and fornication becomes a continuous bloodline, channel, a genealogy, a system, a continuous system that is endless from one generation to the other. It's no longer just a demon, but a sexual idolatry. We are not born of fornication, they said. We have one father, even God. Yes, you are not born of fornication. But how then do you bring the subject of fornication in the subject of submission unto God. Then Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my words. You are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. Now, when he's now talking about them belonging to their father, who is none other than the devil, Jesus then describes the devil as the father of lust. And is trying to give them a clearer picture that you are submitted under your father Lucifer and under the portfolio of lust, whereby you have worshipped the lust of fornication. You have not only worshipped it, but you have committed sexual idolatry by not being obedient to the one whom the Father sent, but being obedient to the father of lust. And by being obedient to the father of lust, you have become custodians of worshippers under sexual idolatry, which is fornication, which is now beyond just a demon, but that demon being a god that rules them under the commitment of fornication. Now, let us go to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 10, verse 1, under the inspiration of Apostle Paul. Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under one cloud, and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and all did eat the spiritual manna, and all did drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock, and that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them, God was not pleased, inasmuch as they were obedient in the wilderness following Moses. But God was not well pleased with them, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now, these things were examples to the intent we should not lust after evil things, is they also lasted. What it means is that those that were delivered from Egypt, most of them, they perished in the wilderness. But the scriptures will only tell you that they were disobedient in the wilderness. But it needs to be known what level of disobedience did they have in the wilderness, which caused most of them not to enter Canaan, including Moses. We are going to get into those details to investigate why Moses and the rest of them did not enter Canaan. And we do know that Moses was then spared by God and then transfigured in the New Testament. But the current investigation is knowing why they failed to enter into Canaan, including Moses, who was then spared and then appeared on the transfiguration in the New Testament. Now, these things are the examples of what caused them not to enter into Canaan. They lusted after evil things. Neither be idolaters, as were some of them, as it is written. Don't be idolaters. Meaning that they committed idolatry. And what form of idolatry did they commit? The people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day, 320,000, which is 320,000, in one day. What you all believe, which caused them to fall, you believe that it was the golden calf. No. Why is it the golden calf had been created? What actually made them fall was fornication. And the idolatry that is being explained here, which made them fall, which made them lust after evil things, was the commitment of fornication. And the Apostle Paul is warning the brethren in Jesus Christ not to commit fornication as they committed. And they all fell, 320,000 in one day. They were struck because of fornication. 320,000, that is almost a nation. The whole nation succumbed to the plague of fornication while it's in the wilderness. Let's go to the book of Jude, chapter 1, verse 6. I was explaining to my wife about the book of Jude, and I said, do you know that we have an apostle that is called Jude, who only wrote 25 verses? Who only wrote one chapter with the 25 verses. But those verses are very few, but they cannot be understood easily. Now, let's go to the book of Jude, chapter 1, verse 6. And it reads, and the angels which kept not first, which failed to keep their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto judgment of the great day. Which angels are those? These are the angels which Enoch wrote about, but Moses is the one that then quoted about those angels. And they are in Genesis chapter 6. But the mysterious thing here is, why then didn't the book of Enoch get enrolled in the scriptures, but it was allowed to be quoted? This is so mysterious up to now. Why we have a book which was excluded from the Holy Bible, but yet the senior prophets and apostles, they quoted from that book. A book which was removed from the other books by Lucifer himself. I'm just diverting, but we are addressing the fornication demon part 2, which is the sexual idolatry. And I felt like I should just go through this part and make it clear that it is the same reason why the Holy Bible has got many versions. It also explains that there were actually many that picked certain books that they wanted, which were actually inspired by God, but they've got specific books which they felt that these books should not become part of the Holy Bible. Now, when you try to bring those other books back, we have got rigid Christians that don't want those books to be read. We have got rigid Christians that don't want those books to be talked about. And part of those books, they have been quoted by Apostle Jude, and they have been quoted even by other preachers in the scriptures and even prophets. And Apostle Jude is talking about the angels which failed to keep their first estate. And these are the angels which entered the daughters of men. The angels that fell because of fornication. How fornication is so dangerous to the level that it made angels fall. But In Genesis chapter 6, they are defined as the Son of God. And these angels, they have been reserved in the everlasting chains under darkness unto judgment of the great day because of fornication. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner giving themselves over to fornication. They gave themselves over to fornication. And when a city gives itself unto fornication, it has not only committed fornication, but it has submitted under fornication, under sexual idolatry, and going after strange flesh, and are set for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Likewise, also these filthy dreamers defile the flesh. Is talking about the dreamers, those that operate in spirit, but whilst they are defiling their own flesh through fornication. And after they defile their flesh with fornication, they despise dominion and speak evil of dignities. Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses. For what matter? I have already explained the matter, which caused the archangel Michael to dispute with Lucifer. You know very well that Lucifer was easily disqualified by angel Michael in heaven, and Lucifer fell here. But now there is a matter which is giving Lucifer a ground to wrestle for the body of Moses, to the level that angel Michael rebukes Lucifer using the name of the Lord. And what was the matter that was being held by Lucifer upon the body of Moses? It can only be the reason, the same reason that caused Moses to fail to enter Canaan. It can only be the same reason of fornication. The accusation which caused many to fall in the wilderness, it was the accusation which was being brought by Lucifer against Moses. If you are not saying it was fornication and you are saying it was idolatry, which idolatry was that? If you are saying it was disobedience, which disobedience was that? It's not disobedience without a name. It was fornication, sexual idolatry. You do know that Miriam was struck with leprosy for questioning Moses, something that was genuine. And the reason why Miriam was struck with the leprosy, that was a matter between Miriam and God. And the matter that was between Miriam and God was, why are you questioning my servant Moses? I, as the Lord, am the only one that is allowed to deal with Moses. After Moses had married out of the rules that he had been given by the same Lord, and he had applied those rules on the Israelites in the wilderness, Moses dies on the mountain and is buried by God according to scripture. And we are not told how Moses dies. But what we know is that Moses went on the mountain as he used to go to talk to God. And his time to depart had come. And there was a war which Apostle Jude is explaining about. Apostle Jude, in his 25 verses, in his one passage, in his one chapter, is able to reveal the reason Why Moses did not only enter the realm of transfiguration automatically? There was a back that pertained Lucifer and the archangel Michael concerning the body and the flesh that had been sacrificed to the idolatry of fornication, to the sexual idolatry of fornication. Fornication is an idolatry. And this is the matter that Lucifer held against Moses. There might be other sins, yes, of disobedience, but the one that Lucifer had against Moses was idolatry. And which specific idolatry? Fornication, sexual idolatry. Child of God, I'm here once again to expose the fornication demon, the sexual idolatry, and praying that you are spared from this fornication demon. A demon that does not only captivate your body, a demon that does not only cause you to sin against your body, as Apostle Paul wrote, but a demon that can cause you to worship the sexual demon, to worship the fornication demon, to worship your lust more than you should worship God, in the name of Jesus.
So